Right now, Gundam and Evangelion are the two big winners. No matter what I make, it's always absorbed by these two. These are the only two that come to mind when I think robot. So recently I've been fixating on the TV anime Gasaraki. I watched Gasaraki as part of my attempt to see everything by its director, Ryosuke Takahashi. He specialized in a certain brand of hard sci-fi, really dry, dense stuff. But Gasaraki is an oddity in his body of work. It's this late 90s post-Ava shibboleth that combines dense political intrigue with mystical dark fantasy elements, directly inspired by, of all things, classical no theater. It's just as unwieldy an execution as that premise probably sounds. I can imagine the show having been pitched to Sunrise, its studio, as their answer to Evangelion, but with Shintoism and no theater replacing Christian imagery. And it has things going for it. Attractive, stylish character designs, a moody aesthetic, and pretty cool mecha. But Gasaraki ended up being kind of an infamous failure in the mecha genre, and just a very bizarre response to Evangelion. Straight up, it's not a good show, but it's one that fails in fascinating and bizarre ways, fixating on unusual themes, and going in directions I never would have anticipated. It's also a show I just don't see talked about very much. So I hope you all enjoy this deep dive into Gasaraki. So Gasaraki came out in the late 90s, a time when director Takahashi was at an interesting moment in his career. In the 1980s, he had directed a number of post-Gundam mecha works, Dogrum, Votoms, Lasner. His work was fairly critically acclaimed, but not always successful. Lasner, for instance, was cancelled midway through production, according to Takahashi, both due to poor kit sales and poor ratings. There was a perception that his work could be lacking in emotion, overly stoic, and that this was preventing their success with a youthful audience. In an interview in 2013, Takahashi related a conversation he had with Sunrise producer Eiji Yamamura before the production of Lasner. "At that time," Mr. Yamamura told me, "your recent work seemed to be too logical, so I thought, I need to make my work more emotional, with more feeling. I think that's why he arranged for me to work with Mr. Ito, because he thought it would be hard for the audience to watch if I didn't put more emotion into it. Please team up with a scriptwriter who has a strong emotional feeling." Takahashi's biggest success had been Votoms, a grimy, conspiratorial series of utilitarian mecha style, which had received several Takahashi-directed sequel OAVs. In the 1990s, Takahashi had mostly set back from directing two core TV series, and seemed to have settled into more of an elder statesman role at Sunrise. He directed projects less frequently, moving into producing series like Gao Gaigar. Gasaraki was an ambitious undertaking for Takahashi, the first full-length series he had directed in several years, and a show with a very complex and rigorous plotline. It was also a collaboration with Toru Nozaki, who would be writing the brunt of the episodes. This would be Nozaki's first screenwriting role, having worked only on series research beforehand. And speaking of plot, synopsizing a Sunrise mecha series is always kind of a fool's errand. It always just sounds like you're describing some unholy mix of like Dune, X-Men, and just watching C-SPAN. But I'm gonna give it a shot. The plot of the opening episodes, at least, is basically this. A strange explosion occurs in this isolated Middle Eastern country, Baljistan, which is really just a very translucent stand-in for Saddam Hussein-era Iraq. Kind of prophetically, America claims the country is developing WMDs, and they prepare an invasion. But we actually follow the mysterious Japanese Goa Corporation. And this is where things get very anime. They believe the explosion is actually related to an ancient, mysterious technology that they've been uncovering. The Goa Corporation are, of course, testing experimental weapons, bipedal manned robots named TAs. And as America invades Baljistan, the Goa Corporation infiltrate the country with a unit of these mecha, investigating ruins they believe are connected to the explosion. But something strange is happening. The Goas insist that one of their machines be piloted by a civilian, and a member of the family, the young Yushiro Goa. So there's quite a lot of elements there, and that's only the first, you know, couple of episodes. You've got strange ancient rituals, political intrigue, and a lot of competing factions. And one of the strangest things about these opening episodes is that they're so dense and so filled with events, I don't know if they can be said to have a main character. Like in theory, from that plot synopsis, you'd probably assume the protagonist would be Yushiro. He's our Shinji analog, the son of the head of the Goa Corporation, who for mysterious reasons is compelled to pilot a mysterious robot. But Yushiro is actually barely in the first five episodes of the series. Also, his dialogue is really minimal. He's a blunt, really reactive figure, closer to Rei Inami actually in characterization. The first five episodes are so flip between so many different perspectives that I don't think any can really be seen as a viewpoint. The drama moves between military command meetings, footage of news broadcasts, and a lot of conversations between the heads of the Goa Corporation, which are all very mysterious and oblique. It's sort of like if Ava was from the perspective of Sele, like if those creepy conspiracy boardroom meetings took up the majority of the first 5 episodes in Ava, but you still weren't really sure what they were conspiring to do. It's very strange. I've basically seen nothing plotted like this. As a Takahashi stan though, I dig these episodes okay. It's interesting to see a mecha series so layered in the imagery of the Gulf War. Episode 4 even directly evokes America's Operation Desert Storm, but of American tanks decimated by mecha, which is an interesting set piece. And I appreciate how flagrant it is in this regard. Like, you have the news broadcasts of SNN, which is really clearly CNN of a very minor alteration. It's a show that's committed to its politics, and kinda unwilling to let the viewer in, but I sort of respect it for being willing to tell such a Byzantine story. And those mystical post-Ava elements are kind of intriguing. Shadowy forces pouncing on a destabilized region to unearth eldritch and ancient relics. This could be a setup for kind of a cool Lovecraftian mecha series. But you can see some contradictions beginning to form, even at the show's start. On one level, this seems like the peak of the Sunrise Real Robot concept. The mecha themselves are like a 90s reworking of the chunky scope dogs from Votoms, which are some of my favourite mecha designs. Also, the plot's political elements feel like a reworking of the Takahashi series Dogrum. That show used a space colonial story to rework imagery of the then recent Algiers conflict, whereas this series goes further, grounding its real robot story in our actual world. And the mecha themselves are painstakingly justified, in a way I've really never seen in the genre. In fact, half of episode 2 is devoted to a military boardroom meeting, in which the plausibility of these mecha are just extensively detailed. It's honestly a little bit painful. It goes on for like 8 minutes.
Bipedal movement allows for a wider range of maneuverability compared to current forms of ground transport. Simply put, this means a TA can transverse almost any terrain a human can, but at higher speeds. We were successful because we reposed the problem. Our previous attempts utilized a centralized stabilization mechanism. The solution was to let the system control itself. Just as you don't normally think about walking, RTA's muscles actually handle 98% of their own control.
However, there's a tension in the show's realistic approach. That's because, as well as being a real robot mecha series, it's also a series taking influence from Ava's occult elements. The show even has a Rey stand-in, on that note, Mihiru, whose design I actually quite like as far as Rey clones go. I mean, look at this outfit. But this is a strange combination. How do you tell a grounded political intrigue story when you're also introducing elements of cosmic horror and metaphysical esotericism? The opening episode exemplifies this tension in an interesting way. It's a fragmented mix of a mecha battle simulation and a no ritual being performed in Japan, which we slowly realize seems to be powering the mecha. These are really cool ideas, very high concept, but it's also very ambitious, and it's never clear if the creators are really in command of all these elements. Mixing the out-there conspiracy fragmentation of Ava with the deeply woven political world-building of our previous Takahashi show. And the fact that there's so little character work in these episodes doesn't really help. Still, I'd say Gasaraki is at its best from around episodes 6 to 13, and I imagine this was a series probably pitched to Sunrise. These episodes also have the least going on. It's basically Yushiro and the military unit in Balochistan investigating strange structures and occasionally encountering this shadowy arms group named Symbol. It also provides this really grounded action that kind of feels like a modern day Votoms. Something Takahashi is really good at is setting his action in environments that feel very reactive. But what really works about the episodes 6 to 13 is that we finally have a regular cast to root the drama in. Yushiro is still very static and reactive, but we begin to have more assertive personalities for him to bounce off. You've got your Masato archetype, you know, the extroverted, fun-going, but capable military commander, and that's always sort of a favourite of mine. There's also a friendly giant, and also the no-nonsense marine, and a military otaku. Don't get me wrong, these are archetypes, but they work well enough, and I think with a little more time, they could have developed some depth. Again, if we see Gasaraki as a reaction to Evangelion, Sunrise trying to do their own version of Ava, then character focus was a huge part of why Ava worked so well. On a macro level, you had conspiracies and mystery and mecha action, but what that show was rooted in were the character dynamics, setting more introverted and reactive characters like Shinji and Rei against these extroverted figures like Asuka, Masato, and that was the viewer's entry point to engage in the narrative. In fact, earlier Takahashi projects did this too. Votoms is about a very mute, scarred character who has been shaped entirely by war, but he's also surrounded by goofballs like these characters. In fact, writer of Votoms, Shoji Yoshikawa, said of the series, "I remember director Takahashi saying, I'm imagining a protagonist who went crazy during the Vietnam War or something, and needs to be rehabilitated inside. I think the idea of getting on a robot and fighting is not an extension of one's own strength, but rather a way of thinking about how to fight. He felt like the character was autistic, and he could express himself by getting into a robot and fighting. It's not Evangelion, but I think it was ahead of its time. That seems to be what these episodes of Gasaraki were also going for, and it's a pity they couldn't have stayed in the style a little bit longer. Something I was thinking about watching these episodes is that Mecha fans understandably complain about Eva fans who haven't seen much Mecha, and say they like that show because, unlike other Mecha shows, it's about the characters. But I think Gasaraki is the kind of series those Eva fans are imagining, because honestly this isn't about characters. And it's not really about Mecha either, it's about the politics and the intrigue and the mystery. But that's a shame because it means the show keeps you at a distance, and it makes an already complex plot much more cold. And this coldness, it only becomes more pronounced as Gasaraki goes on. So around episode 13, the characters return from Baljistan, and there's this arc where Mihiru and Yushiro go rogue from their respective organizations. They go on a journey to Kyoto to discover their mysterious origins. I was actually pretty into this arc at first. It seemed to be giving the show this sort of moody, melodramatic energy that it was really lacking beforehand. There's this brand of kind of post-Gundam Wing, post-Eva Mecha series that I really like, which basically become an excuse for stylish androgynous heroes to have angsty, introspective stories. And that's what they seem to be doing for a while. But once Yushiro and Mihiro reach Kyoto, it goes in a very different direction. There's this extended flashback arc, which, you know, like everything in the show, it's very ambitious. So for a bunch of cosmic loopiness, we find out our two main characters are actually reincarnations of these ancient doomed lovers. So we get this big stylistic departure, where we have two episodes set in the Sengoku period, documenting this. It's presented kind of like a post-war Kurosawa movie. There's even these really cool sequences in black and white, kind of like an old scroll painting. This flashback is also where they hammer down on the show's biggest reveals, which, okay, are you ready for it? So just like Evangelion, the mechs in Gasaraki are actually semi-organic. They're built from cloned tissue, and that tissue is cloned from ancient Onis. I mean, it turns out the Onis are actually left behind by this ancient alien race, but seriously, how cool is that? So Japan used to be ruled by people who could control these Oni, and no theater is actually an ancient method of activating their powers. That's the kind of high concept craziness that I come to Mecha anime for. But these episodes are primarily meant to give more background on Yushiro and Mihiru, two very static and emotionless characters. And they're basically meant to function as a tragedy. In fact, Mihiru is so traumatized by uncovering these episodes that she breaks down in a way very reminiscent of Asuka and Shinji's breakdowns in Eva. I sort of appreciate these episodes as an aesthetic piece, but unfortunately, they totally fail to make us connect with these two characters. In fact, they once again just seem way more interested in introducing all these new political struggles and factions. They focus all in on the world building, to the detriment of actually getting us to know Yushiro and Mihiru and understanding their bond. And I get that this focus on world building is just where Takahashi and co. are probably most comfortable. I mean, after the success of the original Gundam, which along with Yamato basically created the first boom of Attack of Culture, there was this massive hunger for mecha shows that would cater to that very obsessive fan base. And I get that because I'm one of those very obsessive fans. And Takahashi, he basically defined his career by serving that audience, producing mecha series even more dense in their sci-fi minutia than the original Gundam. But here, that style, it totally neuters the emotional impact of these episodes, and make these protagonists kind of unengaging. And while I respect these episodes' ambition, at the very least, it's from here that the show really falls apart in some fascinating ways.
Walk three steps, and thousands of years may pass. Within the confines of the four pillars, even time is but a brief illusion. Merely the sound of your footsteps brings the long-lost voice of the ancient Japanese to my ears.
So after juggling all those elements in the first half, the last 10 episodes or so move away from the themes of no and mysticism, and become a fairly standard coup d'etat story, the kind of thing you'd see in like a Google for Teen manga from the 70s. Despite all those suggestions of eldritch horror, it becomes clear towards the end that the Gowa family's motives are actually sort of banal. They're driven by a right-wing desire to cut Japan off from the international world order and impose a military dictatorship. And honestly, I was pretty surprised by how overtly right-wing this show gets. I mean, if you watch a lot of Sunrise Mecha anime, you do become used to a certain level of kind of ambient nationalism. But I've never seen it at the forefront like this. The Gowa family create an alliance with this far-right figure, Nishida, and the show spends just a wild amount of time on his xenophobic tirades. I'm going to give an example from the show here. It's pretty gross stuff, so if you don't want to hear it, here's the time code.
We can leave our gates open, but we must remove the honey, the lure that draws the flies and parasites into our homeland. The lure of quick wealth is a poison, one which has permeated our land, destroying it from within. What have our people gained from the late 20th century, where everything was driven by greed? They live in a world of immense wealth, and yet they have lost the ability to be aware of the danger of the flow of destitute immigrants into a land that is already unable to provide for itself. Their greed has blinded them, for their eyes will see only that which they desire.
I was initially tempted to see this as a show setting Nishikawa up to be the final antagonist, especially of how ominous the framing and lighting is here. But it doesn't really go in that direction. In fact, it presents him as more of a doomed martyr. In fact, in an interview in the series, Takahashi described Nishida as embodying the spirit of Japanese virtue and refinement. This was particularly surprising to me because I'd always seen Takahashi's work as fairly left-wing. In fact, I'd still say Dogram feels pretty left-wing, particularly of how it takes inspiration from North African liberation movements. There are pretty heavy allusions here to Yukio Mishima, the mid-20th century right-wing novelist who attempted a military coup in the 70s. Mishima himself was interested in and staged No Theater, which I have to imagine is part of the connection. But honestly, this is a strange choice for the show, pivoting into these right-wing military themes for its final arc. And to be clear, our protagonists end up being tasked with ensuring the success of this right-wing takeover. And they succeed, which is basically presented as a good thing. On one level, you know, it's pretty common for these Sunrise Mecha shows to feature protagonists caught up in conflicts and siding with morally gray factions. I just think it hits different when the show is using real-world ideologies, and our protagonists are supporting the equivalent of ultra-nationalists. There's even a scene where we see our main characters mowing down protesters after the coup takes effect. What's worse is that the show never mounts a left-wing or even liberal counterpoint to Nishida's right-wing ideology. In fact, he's presented as a lofty idealist in several scenes.
Your ideas are truly beautiful. But how many of your people do you honestly believe will follow such an ideal when the cost is so high?
I can't imagine this was the initial plan for the show's last round of episodes. Maybe this was the staff realizing they weren't appealing to a wider audience, and going all in on the kind of stuff they thought would appeal to the most right-wing military otaku. But it doesn't help that these episodes are also just incredibly dry. So a big part of the Goa family's plan is to, get this, manipulate the price of wheat. And the show spends just agonizing amounts of time describing the effects of wheat embargoes.
Everything's proceeding exactly as Mr. Nishida predicted.
There's no question that world grain prices will shoot through the roof.
The U.S. Department of Agriculture revealed that the annual grain harvest forecast for this year projects a grain supply of less than 40% of
this
total year.
It appears that the Big Five grain corporations have started negotiations with China.
Hey, what's going on?
The wholesale price of wheat went up $20 a bushel, and this year's global wheat stock supply is 60% below the FAO's minimum safe standards.
A moratorium?
That's correct. A unilateral suspension of grain exports.
It's really gonna suck if they cut back wheat imports. Huh? Well, how can you make a good pizza without wheat dough?
I wish I was exaggerating. It's just such a wild place to take the show. I mean, the show has a wheat arc. And, you know, I'm someone who actually likes how dry Takahashi stuff can be. I mean, Dogram, for instance, that show has an entire episode, which is basically just a town hall meeting, where the main characters are trying to convince farmers of why they should join their cause. And folks, because I'm a sicko, I love that episode. But the wheat arc was too much even for me. The staff were aware of what a break in tone this was, especially after the dark fantasy and metaphysical elements of the show's opening acts. In an interview, character designer Shuko Murasi said of the series, "I had no idea this was going to be such a stoic piece of work. While I did expect the work to be logical and consistent, I was under the impression that by utilizing elements such as no, the narrative would expand towards a more fantastic set of circumstances." But Mr. Nozaki directed the project towards a more stoic tone, and director Takahashi likes that sort of narrative style, so we went with it, which led us to what we have now. So after like 10 episodes of right-wing diatribes and discussing the price of wheat, the Goa family actually succeed in its right-wing coup, facilitated by the main characters, and Japan becomes independent from the world order. But the show returns to its metaphysical elements in the final episode, which is just a completely brazen riff in episode 25 of Evangelion, with live-action footage and metaphysical environments and everything. It's totally brazen.
The point if we're not led by our own will? I will live my own life, even if it is limited.
I want to go home. I want to go home. Back to the people. The people I love.
It's also just wild because the show pretends in its last episode this has been this really subjective psychological exploration of its characters. Like this kind of thing, it feels like a natural extension of Ava's fixation on neuroses. But Gasaraki spends 10 episodes on the mechanics of wheat embargoes, and then acts like this.
Destroyed you.
Arrogance.
Is a suitable place to end the show. Like Takahashi, don't pretend this series is about internal psychology. You all made this thing about the price of wheat.
Well, how can you make a good pizza without wheat dough?
It's also just a really odd episode on like a mechanical narrative level. The plot of the episode is basically that it's revealed that the ancient artifacts that kickstarted the narrative, they were actually housing this ancient alien race who lost their corporeal form and were trapped by their own technology. So the episode is basically the main characters communicating with them after they've finally become freed. And while this episode is like stylistically indebted to Ava, this plot is actually much more reminiscent of the 80s anime Ideon. That show features a cosmically powerful machine imbued with the souls of a dead civilization. It's just really hard to figure out how all of this is meant to thematically connect with what's come before. Like okay, in Evangelion, the human instrumentality stuff, that builds on its central theme. You know, the hedgehog's dilemma, our desire for intimacy in conflict with our fear of rejection. That's basically what Ava is about. And human instrumentality, which merges us into one soul, it becomes a way to explore that theme, because it violently resolves the tension, turning us into one consciousness. And Ideon is this story about universal death and reincarnation, so the move towards really cosmic imagery, it feels very organic. But recording this video essay, I've been trying to figure out how this experimental style fits with Gasaraki's key themes. I mean, the show begins as this kind of meditation on the Gulf War, and then it becomes this pretty right-wing, xenophobic meditation on modernity. So how do those themes connect with all this cosmic imagery and concepts? If you're being really charitable, like really, really charitable, you could maybe argue that Nishida's plan in the show, you know, bankrupting Japan, reversing modernity, you could argue that that parallels this ancient alien plotline. Like how they've been trapped by their own technology. Maybe Nishida is trying to secure a future where Japan doesn't end up like them. And you know, as someone who respects these creators, I do want to give them credit. I know they think about the material in a rigorous way. I want to read this show in a sense that goes beyond, oh, it was the 90s, so the Ava ending. But I don't know, it does feel extremely tenuous. It feels like a show at war with itself, and this ending, it really comes out of left field. After Gasaraki, director Takahashi wouldn't really direct another full-length series. He'd focus on shorter, more art-film-orientated works. For instance, the 12-episode Tezuka adaptation Phoenix, which is great, I'd highly recommend it. And also the faux documentary web series Flag, which actually kind of feels like a more focused Gasaraki. Aesthetically, it's quite similar, but it lacks the mysticism. They're both pretty solid shows, I'd recommend them. I got a chance to meet Takahashi when he gave a Q&A in Scotland in 2011. This was at Scotland Loves Anime, which is the film festival that Anime Limited runs. It was really great to meet him. I was like 18 at the time, huge fan of his shows, and he was really affable and charming. I remember him mentioning the French New Wave a little bit in that Q&A. He seems to be quite into like John Melville, Battle of Algiers, Chris Marker, this sort of thing. So I imagine he was probably happy enough with where he ended up. Toru Nozaki, maybe unsurprisingly, he'd only write for one other anime series, and that series was Flag. Afterwards, he would return to working as a researcher. He's still a Sunrise employee, and he worked as a series researcher in Gundam Hathaway in 2020. So I guess I'm glad he's still working. The assistant director of Gasaraki was Goro Taniguchi. He kind of distanced himself from the series in interviews. He stated, "It seemed that director Takahashi was not intent on doing the Takahashi style of narrative form to push the series through, and Mr. Nozaki has brain capacity far beyond that of ordinary people. So I suppose you could think of me as being a filter that functions between those two and all the other staff, but I would rather argue the title of makeup artist would fit me better." Taniguchi would become a really major player at Sunrise in the ensuing years. He'd arguably define the mecha genre for the next decade with hits like Code Geass. And I think you can see his shows as the exact opposite of Gasaraki. They still involve a little bit of political struggle, but they play out way more like soap operas, with maximum melodrama and a really heavy focus on character relationships and stylist presentation. So you know, he might have learned something from Gasaraki. Shuko Murasi, the character designer, and also a director in his own right, I think is the closest figure to Takahashi currently working at Sunrise. His work continues that realistic style. I think you can see his recent movie Gundam Hathaway as actually a successful example of what Gasaraki was trying to do. It's this muted mecha drama with a really heavy emphasis on politics that also presents its machines more as like horrific kaiju than as heroic figures. Despite everything, I still have some appreciation for Gasaraki, at least for how singular and odd it is. Takahashi remains a favorite director of mine, and I think when you decide to go through a director's work, you start to enjoy even the failures, if only because taken together, they start to tell this story of that director's quirks and obsessions. Throughout this, I've kind of framed Gasaraki as Sunrise's Evangelion response, and I can imagine there might be some disagreements with that. But I do think it's the case. It's just that because of its specific creators, it ended up as something really different. After Ava's release, there was this very definite move by Sunrise to try and capitalize on it. But it wasn't immediately clear what aspect of that show's makeup could be readily expanded on to ensure future success. What was it that made Ava hit so well with the otaku market and a broader audience? Was it the mix of high school life and mecha action? Was it the techno-organic designs, or maybe even the burgeoning moe elements? Eventually, shows like Code Geass and Gundam Seed would make clear how to integrate these elements into the Sunrise fold. But Gasaraki wasn't the show to do that. It's a bizarre, messy, misguided, and above all singular series that could only have come from this very specific creative team. Anyway, thanks for watching. I'd like to thank Zoo Comics for doing the artwork. You can find their work on @ZooComics on Twitter. Also, the majority of the interview sources here were from timeldred.com, a really exhaustive resource with tons of Takahashi material. Ollie Barter's interview with Takahashi was also very helpful. Anyway, thank you, folks.